is Terry Bradshaw, quarterback, Pittsburgh Steelers.
It's 7:15. There's a new home run champion of all time, and it's Henry Aaron.
This is baseball, Major League Baseball. And this is
ABC's Monday Night Baseball, live from Fenway Park in Boston, Massachusetts.
Looking, he's under the gun. He's fired, he's thrown. It is!
Again, everybody, and welcome back to another episode of the Past Our Prime podcast. I'm Scott Johnston with my compadres Bill Mahoney.
Let's get it on.
And Mark Hoffman.
Your last name's Mahoney?
It is. Right. It is. I changed it from Hoffman the other day.
What do we do here? Well, we kind of just goof off and talk about sports, but what we do is we go back and look at old Sports Illustrateds, usually online, but Mark actually has a old copy of the issue we'll be talking about today, which is UCLA losing to North Carolina State. Another one in our series of doing a show whenever UCLA loses a game. They're our front and center, but in all honesty, they were such a dynasty, and we're coming in on the end of that run. So Monty Towe of North Carolina State and the Wolfpack beat the Bruins in the semis and then beat Marquette to win it all. Mark, do you remember much of that game?
Oh, I remember everything about that game. And I'm going to give another plug to my friend Mark Borson, because I told the story that I was at his house watching UCLA lose to Notre Dame when the 88 game winning streak ended. Well, I was at Mark's grandfather's house, who was a big Bruin backer, had season tickets, and we were watching that UCLA North Carolina State game, the three of us, very intently. And it was a really good game. Double overtime game, yeah. But I remember that painfully so.
Yeah, well, you know, you don't have to think about, oh, I remember this loss and this loss and this loss. Oh, and that, you know, there's only three of them. There's only three losses in like 4 years. Not that hard to remember. But you losing in the tournament, that was the first time they had done that since the mid-60s,
I
guess.
And here's 66, the funny thing. Man. Back then, you lost in the semifinals. Like now, you lose in the semifinals, you go home. Back then, they made them play a third-place game.
Right.
So UCLA had to play, you know, Kansas 2 days later in the third-place game. And it's like, we don't want to be here.
Right.
Frankly, yeah. UCLA, North Carolina State should have been the finals, because that would have been epic. You know,
right.
It was so anticlimactic after
really
that, because you knew North Carolina State was going to beat Marquette.
Although, you know, you always worry about a letdown, because they just slayed the Giant. Yeah. And now they had to get back up for Marquette. So basically, we look back at sports from 50 years ago and go cover to cover, issue by issue. Some of the articles we decide were not worthy of our time then and are not worthy of our time now. They usually have to do with billiards and bridge and
hunting.
All that. Hunting. Hunting's a good one to just zip right through. It's, it's like looking at commercials in today's television. You just hit the fast forward button.
I think there was a steeplechase in
this,
and I thought, well, I got nothing there.
They're big on the steeples.
Yes.
I see in the letter from the publisher, they had a thing on their the SI senior editor named Scott Levitt. Now, first of all, Scott's one of those guys who messes up the name Scott for people like me, because he spells it with one T.
Oh.
And that
nerve.
Just, you know, every once in a while when I have to spell my name, my last name's Johnston. That I understand, because the typical name is Johnson. So I've got to put the T in there. I don't normally have to spell my first name, but every once in a while, can you spell that for me, please? I'm like, S-C-O-T-T, the way it's supposed to be spelled.
You know, the first time I met you, or the first couple times, I wasn't sure if it was Johnson or Johnston. So...
You've got probably the same thing with the last name being Hoffman.
Because, also the C in his name.
It's right. one F. And it's
typically a two F.
I think what had happened is I think the name was actually spelled Hoffmann, which wasn't as uncommon in Germany. But when my parents came to this country or my dad came to this country in processing, they probably somehow lopped off that last N, and that's how we got the weird spelling.
We have some very strange names in this country based on people at Ellis Island that could not spell to save their lives.
I know that I remember living in Vegas, and I went up to do something, and the lady said my name, asked my name. I said, Bill. She goes, could you spell that? I said, QRLDBILL. The first four letters are silent. She had that look on her. I said, it's BILL, you know?
I had one where it would be like, I'd say, what's your name? And I'd say, it's Mark Hoffman. And they say, is that with a C or a K? And I'd go, oh my God, not a lot of people would ask if Mark is spelled with a C or K. It's with a C. She goes, no. Kaufman, is that with a C or a K?
Pam. P-A-M-M?
Yeah. That's right. It's the two M's.
That's taking a play out of Bill's playbook right there.
Oh, yeah.
But anyway, Scott Levitt was an unusual dude, very competitive in everything he did, including walking. He would go for walks while at work in Manhattan. And on his walks from the Time Life building to Grand Central Station, he tried to get other pedestrians to walk into things. So when he was about to overtake you, he would cut you off and lead you into a pick, like a lamppost. So he had a, hard time making friends, but he certainly was very entertaining to himself, let's say.
And no lawsuits?
Yeah, that's serious. That's what he did.
Yeah.
Wow, that's
isn't that nice?
Quite a guy.
On the scorecard, you guys got anything?
Oh, yeah. But that there was no current black players that played in the Masters in 74. I mean, I when I looked at that, I kept thinking, no, that can't be true. Lee Elder was in 75. Mm-hmm. But I just thought, boy, that's not that long ago.
Well, I was thinking about it. It's not that surprising. Yeah, I didn't even know that there was a black tour.
Yeah.
And that makes all the sense in the world because they weren't allowed to play a lot of those courses or on the PGA Tour. And
a lot of country clubs.
Right.
I mean, you have Tiger Woods, but, even now you have the same
issue. Right. You're right. There's not a lot. Yeah.
I like the Guppy love story. That girl, Carol Klug, a freshman at St. Gregory's College, she fell in love with this Siamese fish, a fighting fish, and the fish would wag its tail like a dog and stuff. And I thought, that's crazy. And then I thought, we had a goldfish named Rosetta, and Rosetta was like that. My daughter would get all excited. You'd walk into the room, she'd see you, and she'd start wagging her tail at you like she was a dog or something.
Really?
And acknowledge that you were there.
Was that really big one you had? The one that kept growing, it was like it was like 3 feet.
The man-eating one, yes.
Yeah, they never died. He used to have a goldfish. Usually they're teeny. Mark had one that was like, a foot long and
the
fat.
The flounder.
Yeah, wow. It was,
Nice.
Dang.
Anything from you, Billy?
Yeah, we got the, this one's going to be a little long, so I won't go on this, but I'll say about Henry Aaron's ball that surpassed Babe Ruth that might sell, they're thinking, for $15,000. Mm-hmm. Then you go up a few years, Mark McGuire's home run number 70. $3 million.
Right.
$3 million. And Bonds number 73 was $518,000. So I don't know. I would think that ball at this point in time, I couldn't find where it is and where the price is, what it would be. Yeah.
Crazy. The McGuire one, I'm pretty sure that they offered him a few bats and a couple jerseys. And he was okay with that, but he wanted to meet McGuire, I think.
Yeah.
And they said no. And so he said, all right, then I'll keep it. And then he sold it for $3 million.
And that was, I think someone, there's one of those big buyers out there that jumped in real quickly and bought that, thinking that it was going to go higher than $3 million. He was stuck with it.
And then they had the Year of the Tiger on the Chinese calendar. So they were talking about how there was hope maybe for Auburn or LSU or Clemson, which didn't work out. And I'm looking at the years, and the last one was in 2022. The next one's in 2034, which means that the Detroit Tigers have no hope this year.
Well, that's so, lately though too.
Yeah.
But Scott, did you guys look at the? This is sort of long. Maybe we all pitch in if we saw it. Dr. Arnold Mandel talked about all the positions. He analyzed, a psychiatrist analyzed them all. Came up with quarterbacks are the most arrogant. And the, what is it, halfbacks are sneaky and elusive. A fullback will punch you in the nose, but a halfback will stab you in the back. That's supposed to be their psychological tendencies. And it says a linebacker is analytical, intelligent, and highly controlled. They'll kill if given permission. They'd make excellent assassins.
Wow.
So, yeah. Sounds like a pitbull. And then they said defensive line. They'll kill you too, but only for the fun of it. Usually casual and sloppy. So I'm saying odd.
I love that.
Yeah, yeah.
Those damn halfbacks. Yeah.
And then last one was Ed Batakowski, the referee, asked where his daughter was born, and he said, Philadelphia at Milwaukee.
I know, right? Right. So when he was talking about the halfbacks, was he talking about OJ in particular stabbing? Or...
That's right.
He had someone in mind?
Well, I think the article just cut deep in terms of what it was trying to come.
Oh, God.
Come on, Mark. Throw one in. You can come out of your shell just a teeny bit.
All right, let's move on to the cover story, which was Nothing Could Be Finer by our good friend Curry Kirkpatrick. And it was the end of a run. UCLA loses, not in the finals, mind you. They lose in the semis to North Carolina State, the Wolfpack's first national championship, ending the Bruins' seven-year stretch of winning the title. It was Bill Walton's last game in college, possibly the greatest player in college basketball history. And then NC State has to get up after beating UCLA in overtime. It was an overtime
double
game.
Double overtime
game. That's right. They have to play Al McGuire and Marquette. They win 76-64 to win it all. They grabbed a one-point lead, Marquette did, before McGuire got a technical. David Thompson hit some free throws. Tom Burleson scores inside twice for North Carolina State. Marquette's called for goaltending, and NC State has like a nine-point lead at the half, and they pull away. But for many, the real championship game, which is somewhat disrespectful to Marquette, but was NC State number one against number two UCLA. And the Bruins and NC State had played earlier that year.
At a neutral court.
Yeah, UCLA got
I believe it was in St. Louis.
Yeah, they took them
by
18.
It was actually a close game until the very end, and then UCLA started pulled away. So the final score was a little misleading. That set up the big showdown.
Yeah, they won by 18. And we've talked about this in the past, about how Wooden comes off as this very, you know, quiet, unassuming man.
Father figure.
But he played head games with his opponents. Yeah. And he wanted North Carolina State to dwell on that first number of 18 that they had taken it to them. And it may have backfired because NC State was going through a little bit of some injuries at the time. They weren't fully, I mean, they only lost one game all season long. But I think that they kind of used that as a chip on their shoulder. UCLA led in the championship game by 11.
Twice.
Yeah, 57-46.
Yeah, right?
Yeah. And in overtime as well.
And they were up by seven in overtime. Yeah.
But double in the second overtime.
But NC State behind the unbelievable David Thompson, who had 28 points, including a bank shot with 1:18 to play, gave them the lead. And when Monty Towe hit two free throws with 12 seconds left, the seven-year run, the last we'll ever see of anything like that, had come to an end. UCLA's dynasty, although they would win the championship the next year, so it's not fair to say the dynasty was over, but that run was over.
Nine out of 10.
Yeah, 9 out of 10. I mean, only if they would have won in 66, you'd be saying 10 in a row. That's unbelievable.
Right? Speaking of, joining us now is one of the giants of that NC State championship team, the starting point guard, Monty Towe, who I just mentioned, who ran that team perfectly back then, a 30-1 record. The year prior, they were undefeated, but they were on probation, not allowed to go to the tournament. That NC State team, one of the greatest in NCAA history.
Yep.
No doubt about that. Monty, welcome to the Past Our Prime podcast. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you. It's great to listen to you guys. I enjoy the talk about the names and all those things. My name was T-O-W when my my ancestry came over. They changed it to T-O-W-E. So I understand all the name deals, and I'm so happy we beat UCLA that afternoon. and then Marquette in the championship. It's made our lives. We just had a 50-year reunion this past weekend in Raleigh, where I think we helped the North Carolina State Wolfpack beat up on Boston College in the basketball game. I think they were trying to impress David Thompson and Tommy Burleson and the guys that were there. But it's been a great life, and that was a great day for us to be able to beat UCLA in the semifinals and then, you know, eventually win the national championship a couple nights later.
Yeah, you know, 50 years ago, I'm sure in some ways it goes by a blink and in the blink of an eye, but did you know at that time that that single moment would have such an impact on the rest of your life?
I had no idea. When I was 13 years old, I watched Bobby Joe Hill strip Louis Dampier playing for Texas Western against Kentucky right towards the end of the first half, and Texas Western went on to win. And then 8 years later, I'm playing in the national championship game and trying to help a team beat one of the greatest, maybe the greatest dynasty of all time in college basketball. So just unreal then, unreal now, but I'm sure glad I was a part of it. We had great leadership in Norm Sloan. We had a great player in David Thompson. Tommy Burleson was a great player as well. And we had a wonderful team. We got a bunch of guys that had each other's backs. And for 2 years, we played as well as anybody in the nation. And then we got the opportunity to win a national championship. You have to respect the fact that we delivered. You know, we did the job. David, I'd like to mention, had a you know, the fall that he had the weekend before. There's a lot of things that could have happened. In today's game, he probably wouldn't have been able to play in the semifinals or the finals because of his injury the week before. So a lot of great times for us, and we were lucky, but we were also very, very good.
Yeah, you mentioned the David Thompson fall, and if anyone sees that video, it is very scary, and how he was able to escape without a serious injury is just, to me, amazing.
It was the worst. Like, when he was laying there, the game was going on, and then all of a sudden he wasn't moving. And when he left the court on a stretcher, we didn't know whether he, first of all, was alive, because he really wasn't moving. And then whether he had a broken neck or whether he had a concussion. And we played that game with tears in our eyes, and somehow we were able to get it together enough to you know, win that basketball game. But part of the deal was he came back in the arena with about, you know, 7 or 8 minutes to play and walked in while the game was going on. And we just stopped playing and went over and hugged him and just so happy to see him. So a really weird situation emotionally. But thank God he was all right. Thank God he was able to play the next weekend.
And for people that don't know what we're talking about, if you see the video, he almost does a somersault, and he actually, his head bounces off the floor. So it's a very horrific-looking injury. I am, by the way, Monty, I am a UCLA alum, so that was a very, very painful day for me watching that game. So
that's okay. You've had a lot of good days.
Yes, yes, yes.
Thank you.
How much did that loss during the season, which at surface looked like a blowout, but it was actually a close game until the very end. How much did that game during the season help as a motivating factor for when you met again in the semis?
Yeah, we were still getting our act together for the team that we were. We added two really good players, Morris Rivers and Phil Spence, to the team. We went undefeated 72-73, Joe Cafferty, Rick Holt, seniors. We replaced them with Phil Spence and Mo Rivers, and we were still learning out about who we were. I'm glad you say that it was a close game for most of the game. Then all of a sudden it got out of hand at the end. But I think it helped us. When people used to play the great New York Yankees, Maris and Mantle days, they say they lost before the game started because they were looking at the pinstripes. That's the same way it was in college basketball with UCLA. And I think that broke that barrier, that we were able to play against them. And then we felt like we were a better team when we played them in the semifinals. And they also showed some vulnerability down the stretch. They lost a couple of games. Notre Dame beat them. We rose to the occasion, and it was a great day for us. And since you're a UCLA fan, a bad day for you. I'm sorry.
How was it when you came in? A lot of times UCLA had a great team, obviously, with Walton and the players. But John Wooden sitting there on the sidelines. Was it intimidating to look over at him knowing how great a coach and person he was?
The whole thing was intimidating. The fact that Marcus Johnson and Richard Washington sat on the bench and didn't play a single minute in the game that we played against them in the semifinals. Their whole deal was intimidating. We'd all obviously grown up watching UCLA win national championship after national championship. I thought Bill Walton was one of the best, or if not the best player I've ever seen. And I think Coach Wooden thought that team was one of the best teams he ever had, even though they didn't win the national championship. So the whole thing was intimidating, but I've always told people, whenever you walk on the floor with David Thompson and Tommy Burleson, you have a chance to beat anybody. And I think we showed that in winning in two seasons, 57 out of 58 games.
Getting back to that UCLA game, we had mentioned that you guys were down by 11 with about 11 minutes to go, and then you were down by 7 in the second overtime. Was there ever a point in that game where you guys, I don't know, not say doubted yourself, but said, this is really going to be tough? How did you rally yourself to prevail?
I'm not sure how it all happened, but I just know that I played with a bunch of guys that were really tough guys. David Thompson, Tommy Burleson, Tim Stoddard, Morris Rivers, myself, Phil Spence, just really tough guys. And we had gotten behind before. Early in the year, we went to Purdue, played them on their home court when they had a really good team, won the NIT tournament that year when there were only 24 teams at the NCAA tournament. And we were down 15 in the second half and came back and won the game. So we had done this before on the road. This was a neutral court, and we were just able to do what we had to do to win the game. And we were all about winning. David Thompson was always about winning the basketball game. Tommy Burleson was always about winning the basketball game. And Timmy Stoddard, one of the greatest winners of all time, World Series rings with the Baltimore Orioles. Tough guys and guys that like to win. And sometimes you have to figure out a way to win, and somehow we were able to do it that day.
How important was it for Burleson to play Walton even in that game?
It was very important. Walton was the best player in the country, along with David Thompson. And I do remember a period of the game that is one of my favorite times at North Carolina State. Burleson got two fouls in the first half, and Stoddard had to guard Walton man-to-man for like the last, I'm not sure whether it was 4 minutes or 6 minutes of the first half, but Stoddard is still under investigation for assault in the city of Greensboro, North Carolina, for the 6 minutes he put on Walton defensively in that first half. It was a wonderful performance by Stoddard. What a strong guy. I never went anywhere without Stoddard, and he really manhandled Walton, really helped us get into the second half and be able to win the game.
Monty, you get to NC State, and you're kind of the basketball version of Rudy, right? Only with skills. But you're 5 feet nothing, 100 and nothing. What gave you the confidence to play at an elite level despite your lack of size?
Yeah, I don't know. I must have been nuts, you know? I always loved basketball. I loved all sports. And I was just going to try to be as good as I could be and reach the highest level that I could reach. And I was fortunate to get a scholarship to North Carolina State. I could have gone, some other places, but Norm Sloan was good enough to give me an opportunity to play. And I had the greatest teammates in David Thompson. We came in the same year as freshmen. And in that year, that was the last year of freshman ineligibility. So we played on a freshman team. Tim Stoddard was also a member, a very important key member of that national championship team, and also this same freshman class that came in 71. So just being around these great people and having a great opportunity, and then being able to deliver when the opportunity presented itself. I always thought I was an ordinary guy, being 5'7", and everybody else was just, a little bit taller. So it was no problem. I just love basketball, and I'm still a high school coach and 70 years old and still enjoy what I'm doing. And basketball has been great for me. And that day particularly was a great day for me.
I got to talk. I know you say you're 5'7", I'm 5'7". You kick ass, man. I looked at your I looked at your past. You were great in baseball. You were great in football. You shot 80s in golf. You pretty much any sport you tried to play, you did well at. Is there something out there you don't do well?
Yeah, I'll probably sit still, you know.
I know another 5'7" guy in here just like that.
Recess was my favorite class.
Me too.
That would give you a tip. But, no, I had great parents and got a college education. And just I love sports growing up. Kickball, dodgeball, kick the can. You can throw those other sports in there too. We had a group when I was growing up in high school that virtually played all those sports together, basketball, football, baseball, and golf. And just a wonderful experience to be in the sports world. I enjoy reading. I enjoy, you know, watching movies and stuff on TV, but I don't know about sports. I don't know if I would have made it, you know, without sports and being able to do the things that I do. I've got to do a shout out for my high school football team. We went undefeated 2 years in a row.
That's right.
I was the quarterback, but I really didn't have anything to do with it because our defense held the opponents to one touchdown my junior year and two touchdowns my senior year. So the baseball, I started at North Carolina State as a second baseman my freshman year. Actually, when I went to North Carolina State, I wasn't sure whether I was going to play basketball or baseball, but I ended up playing both along with Tim Stoddard. Sam Esposito was my college baseball coach, and he was also our assistant basketball coach. And the people that know the baseball world know the true value of a guy like Sam Esposito, who played behind Nellie Fox and Louis Aparicio, but was a 10-year Major League Baseball player. But he was my college baseball coach and my assistant basketball coach.
Now, David Thompson gets all the headlines on that team and a little bit Tom Burleson. But I contend you're the glue to that team. Without you, no matter how great David Thompson is, you can't win a championship. You averaged nearly 13 points a game. You scored 12 in that game against UCLA. But to me, the point guard is always the glue for a team and the key for that team's success. Wouldn't you agree?
Well, you've got to have all the pieces. I think I did what I was supposed to do. I loved Al McGuire. And after the national championship game, he had a quote that said, you know, forget about that guy Thompson and Burleson. He said that little white guy was going around us like he was trying to run the Olympics, you know, around my guys. So I did what I was supposed to do. I had a great opportunity. I took advantage of it. I can't tell you how much a value it was to play with a great player, one of the greatest players of all time, David Thompson. And in my opinion, maybe the second best player ever to play at North Carolina State and Tommy Burleson. They were both North Carolina kids. Coach Sloan was able to recruit both of them. And I was able to fall in there and do what I was supposed to do. Coach Sloan said, get the ball across half court. Don't get trapped. Pass the ball to David and Tommy and win every game. And I tried to do that.
You executed the game plan rather well, rather well. I wanted to just say, getting back to your size real quick, did you use that to your advantage? Because I have to imagine that you'd walk out onto the court and they might discount what they were going to go up against. Could you not only use that as motivation, but then surprise the hell out of them at how good you were?
Well, I assume I did use it as motivation, but my father always told me that, you know, if a coach is going to look at a player and he's going to see somebody your size than somebody bigger, you have to be better than the guy that's bigger. And I always tried to be better than the guy that was bigger. And it always seemed natural to me. I really didn't feel that small on the court. As I look back on the film today, I really was. But I used it as motivation, chip on my shoulder, but I like to compete. And I always thought I belonged out there. You know, it was a, you know, a game of talent. I tried to play to my strengths, which was my passing, my quickness, my recognition of what was going on the floor, my mental awareness of the overall game. And not to be the end of it, but maybe the beginning, I made sure, particularly when I was in college in pro ball, that I got the ball to the right guy. And fortunately, most of the time, that was David Thompson.
A lot of people have not seen David Thompson play, and they don't understand the kind of player he was. What made him so special?
Well, the great person, great player, spectacular athlete. Broke the North Carolina State triple jump record the first time I ever tried it at North Carolina State as a freshman. Just a wonderful person. Very humble, which I think is one of his greatest talents, is that he is the greatest ever, the GOAT of the ACC, and still humble. His teammates loved him. He worked hard at practice every day, and great shooter, better shooter, underestimated shooter because of his ability to get to the basket. He was fearless in attacking the rim and shot blocking. He could come out of nowhere to block, you know, somebody like a Walton shot. So spectacular. He could turn a game almost on a play, just a guy, kind of player that could, you know, make a spectacular play and turn a game. Great competitor, great winner, tried to win at every drill and practice, and just a great friend. So I love the guy. We all got together this past weekend, and we were all able to share some great times. And certainly he was the catalyst of us being able to do all of the things that we did.
We're talking with Monty Towe, the point guard for that incredible North Carolina State Wolfpack championship team from back in 1974. Tom Burleson and Thompson. And I think we might have spotted you on the cover there of Sports Illustrated from back in the day, Monty. But you guys, end of an era, it says. I just wanted to talk a little bit more about David Thompson, because you and him are somewhat credited with a play that is now common in the basketball world, and that's the alley-oop. The only problem is that back then dunking was illegal, because that's a real shame. I imagine David could put on a show if he was allowed to do so.
Well, I've seen him break backboards in the summertime at summer camps when we were playing. I think the NCAA, I don't know why they ever would have outlawed the dunk in the first place, but they certainly missed one of the most spectacular acts of all time by not allowing David Thompson to be able to dunk. But actually, it turned into a play, the alley-oop, where as a freshman, he was so good that people were done. All the guys that were trying to play against him in practice started denying him the ball, because once he got the ball, you couldn't stop him. He would drive, shoot, do whatever he wanted. And they overplayed him. One day he went back door. I threw a pass. It looked like it was leaving the arena. He caught it, laid it in. We thought that looked pretty good. And it was just a play that we didn't have any call for it. We just did it. And David was the one that made it all happen. Stoddard also made that pass frequently. But David and I got a lot of credit for it. The first guys that I ever saw throw an alley-oop was John Brody and R.C. Owens with the San Francisco 49ers. So that's football. First guys that did it in basketball might have been us, but we don't get any, at least I don't, any NIL money. money. So I'm just glad that we did what we did. But David was really the one that could make it happen. And not being able to dunk, he actually made more spectacular plays maybe by catching it and dropping it. If you guys don't remember, you're too young, but you had to drop it and your hands couldn't enter the circle of the rim. Oh. So you had to pull your hands back, and it was somewhat of an artistic play. Mm-hmm. And David was the one that made it so artistic. As Stoddard said this weekend, a lot of bad passes made good by David.
Let me ask, I'm looking at the cover and there's Bill Walton and David Thompson right next to each other. Walton's jumping. David Thompson's hand is above his. Mm-hmm. How high could David Thompson jump? How high had you ever seen him jump?
Just seemed like as high as he needed to jump. He could jump high, and as the defender was coming down, he was still going up. Sometimes they say, you know, he could take a quarter off the top of the backboard. If you put enough money up there in his prime, I would say I wouldn't put the money up there, you know. So the greatest leaper that I've ever played with, but also a basketball player. He wasn't just a leaper. He was a great basketball player. So the combination made him the player that he was. But it was also the person, the humility, the competitiveness, and just the desire for his team to win the basketball game.
Have you seen the cover of that Sports Illustrated? Have you actually seen the picture?
Well, I'm sure I have. My mother kept all those scrapbook pictures. And in the 2 years that we went 57-1, we were on the cover of Sports Illustrated. Not we, but David was on there. I believe Tommy was on there. So Sports Illustrated, even though being known as a University of North Carolina sports-oriented magazine, they were still getting our guys on the cover a lot. And I think I remember that cover. I'm sure I've got it in my scrapbook. My mother kept the greatest scrapbooks ever, so I'm sure it's in there.
Because it's funny, because Bill was talking about how David's hand is above Bill's, and it looks like you're behind Burleson, and it looks like your hand is grabbing Walton's hair. from
him. Hey, I was always in there messing around.
Right? That's good, Mark.
As a defender, I wasn't a great defender, but I think I was a pest. And I was always in there trying to help and dig out, balls that big guys would put on the floor. And I was also one of those guys that my main deal was winning the basketball game. And I think a lot of us hooked up, that liked to win. And Norm Sloan was our leader. And great time for us.
For many people, the Duke-Kentucky game in 1992 is considered to be the greatest game in college basketball history. But up until that game, they say that the ACC final between North Carolina State and Maryland may have been the greatest game in college basketball history. Two great teams. Maryland, people forget this, only one team per conference could go to the tournament. So Maryland, a wonderful, incredibly great team, loses to you guys in overtime, 103-100. Just an unbelievable game. But a little bit before the era where all those games were televised and everyone saw everything, so it doesn't quite get the props it deserves. What do you remember about that game?
Big time pressure game, and played against a great team. A team that we'd beaten five consecutive times over the last 2 years, but we still had to beat them in order to go on to the NCAA tournament. And they were playing so good. They had great players, John Lucas, Tom McMillan, Lynn Elmore. And the pressure of the situation was we'd gone 2 years to the ACC undefeated in regular season. We'd won the previous year's ACC tournament. We'd won two Big Four tournaments, but we still had to win this game against a great team in order to get into the NCAA tournament. And for us to be able to win that game was an incredible experience for me. Tommy Burleson scored 38 points, was the Everett Case Award winner, MVP of the tournament. And the pressure that was involved in that game was an incredible feeling. It was a game that a lot of people think changed all of college basketball. I think next year they went to 32 and then, 48. And then 64. So no ESPN, a little bit ahead of our time, but a pressurized situation for us. And we were able to come out of that game victorious. But a great Maryland team. Lefty Driesell coaching that team. They couldn't stop David Thompson. They chose not to double on Burleson. And he scored 38 points, motivated by the fact that he had been named second team All-ACC. And Elmore was first team All-ACC. Highly motivated Tommy Burleson for that game.
Going back to the UCLA North Carolina State game, the game was so big that, and we're going to cover this later in our show, that there was a golf tournament going on, the Heritage Classic in South Carolina at Hilton Head. And Johnny Miller was playing in the tournament. And he had a 10-stroke lead, and all of a sudden the lead started disappearing. And they asked why, and he said because he was so worried about UCLA, he was listening to the game while he was playing golf. That's how big the game was.
Yeah, and his lead went from 10 strokes down to 4 or 3 or something like that. I mean, he really started tanking.
So the effect you guys had on other athletes or sports people.
I think our team had a great impact on the overall country. The country was like probably 50-50, probably 50% of the people wanted UCLA to win and 50% wanted us to win. I just think our whole team, David Thompson, how could you not like him? Tommy Burleson, myself, Norm Sloan, we were somewhat of a circus team, and I think we had a great impact on people. And I'm very thankful we had a great impact on Johnny Miller, because I saw him shoot that 63 in the U.S. Open on TV. It was one of the greatest rounds I ever saw.
You know, we the guy that wrote the article back then was Curry Kirkpatrick. We reached out to him and had him on our show a week or so ago. He wrote something about you that I thought was really nice, and I'll read it to you. He says, "A trickster type full of showmanship. He was such a fast, fascinating player in his own right. He could have been the main attraction on most other teams." Was there ever been a thought of you that what it would have been like to sort of have your own team?
Well, I've never seen that. I'm not sure where you're quoting that from.
From him, but from Curry.
We asked him to send us a quote about you. Covering you guys. Yes. So he just, okay. And he basically wrote a column for us.
He did.
It was amazing.
He did.
I've had a lot of great times with Curry, and he's a great writer. And for him to say something like that is, very thoughtful of him, and I'm humbled by what he says. But I loved going to North Carolina State. I might have been able to do other things at other places, but I don't even think about that. I just think about my times at North Carolina State and the opportunity that I had and I was able to take advantage of. And I appreciate Curry. He was always covering us. Curry was always, he was at the Big Four tournaments, ACC tournaments, and a good friend. And I can't tell you how much that means for him to say something like that. Thank you.
He thinks you're the best. He literally, Scott asked me, he goes, write Curry and see if he'll say something about Monty. So he did. Let Scott. Yeah, he wrote back like two paragraphs about how great you are. Yeah, about how great
was,
you are.
It was really, really sweet. You know, you play in that UCLA game. It goes to double overtime, and you play all 50 minutes in that game. So physically, you've got to be a little bit drained. And then you've just beaten the 7-time defending champions. So mentally, you've got to be a little bit drained. And yet you still have to play the championship game 2 days later. I often think of the Miracle on Ice team, the USA team. You know, they beat Russia, and then they've got to beat Finland to win the gold. Like, how do they get back up for that game? How did you guys not have a letdown against Marquette? I know it's a championship game, and that sounds kind of crazy. But was there any of that, you know, going into the championship?
Now, Coach Sloan took care of that as soon as the UCLA game was over in the locker room. He said, enjoy this for a few minutes, but we haven't done what we want to get done, and that's win the national championship. So we enjoyed the victory. I played all 50 minutes. Morris Rivers also played all 50 minutes in that game. Morris actually played all 90 minutes of the semifinals and the finals. He played the 50 minutes of the UCLA game, and then he played the 40 minutes of the Marquette game. But I don't remember being tired. I never liked coming out of a game. I played a lot of minutes, and we enjoyed, staying on the floor. So emotionally, I just think Coach Sloan got us in the right frame of mind as soon as the UCLA game was over. Even though we had beaten UCLA, we still had to win one more game to, do what we wanted to do, and that's win the national championship. So I give Coach Sloan a lot of credit for that and give our team a lot of credit for understanding – we have a job to do. We're not done yet, and we need to get this done one more time.
And tell me about your relationship with Sloan. Not only did he recruit you, but he also helped you get jobs after basketball. What do you remember about him?
Yeah, just a great person, a great coach, a great father, a great husband, a great friend of mine. And he also gave me the opportunity to play college basketball at North Carolina State. And then he also gave me the opportunity to start my coaching career in 1978 as an assistant coach at North Carolina State. So I miss him dearly. I always relied on his intelligence and just his opinion on anything that I would do. And just has given me the opportunity to be sitting here talking to you guys. I miss him dearly and still have contacts with his family, but he was also, beyond everything else he did, like I said earlier, he was a very good friend.
So we do a segment here on the show called 50-50, where I ask you, I give you a 50% chance to answer a trivia question from 50 years ago. But I'm going to sort of break it a little bit here because we can. And here's your trivia question, okay? Because you're such
Do I have a right to not answer or just go ahead and do it?
Well, it'll be easy. It's yes or no. So.
Oh, I can do that. Yeah. I can do that.
Okay. So because we're talking so much North Carolina State, the comedian, actor, Zach Galifianakis. Thank you, because I can't say it. True or false, he is a North Carolina State alum.
I hope so.
You yes. are correct.
Let it go.
So
a member of the Wolfpack.
Yeah. Yes, he was me. Yeah, they're great. Right. They were the Wolfpack.
They were the Wolfpack in the movie.
Now, which guy is he? Which guy is he?
He's the short guy with the beard, the brother-in-law, the one that's always doing the dumb things. So
he's the one who Mike Tyson punches.
Yeah, yes, exactly. Knocks him out cold. Yeah.
Mike Tyson still got it.
Go Wolfpack.
Yes. Yes.
And not only did Zach graduate there, but John Tesh, the composer.
For NBA.
Someone you won't know, Monty, but Bill knows very well, Jill Wagner, the host of Wipeout, graduated North Carolina State. And Bill was on Wipeout.
There you go.
And he got wiped out. The game show, that is.
Yes, he did. We are going back 50 years and looking at these old issues of Sports Illustrated, and with that comes a lot of teams that are celebrating 50-year anniversaries. We talked with Bob Thomas of Notre Dame after they beat Alabama. We talked to Larry Zonka after they won their second Super Bowl in a row. All these guys, including you, the championship is great, don't get me wrong. But the relationships and the bonds that were formed that then lasted a lifetime, that seems to be the prevailing overall number one thing that these people take from the experience they had. Is that true with you as well?
They supersede everything you did. And you won a national championship. You did it together. This weekend, I can walk in to the hotel at 6:30 a.m. and there's Stoddard and Burleson sitting there drinking coffee. And we haven't seen each other for a long time. Stoddard, not very much. And it's like we were just playing basketball yesterday for North Carolina State University. So it's one of those deals where you just feel good around people and you know what you did and you're proud of each other and you're so happy to see each other. And you're really, brothers, you've done a great job together. And it's a significant thing. The national championship is wonderful. Absolutely great. As you get older and older, the relationships probably become the biggest deal.
Monty, I can't thank you enough for spending some time with us today. Get back to doing your high school coaching. I'm sure those kids are lucky to have you. We were lucky to be able to chat with you about what was a great moment in college basketball history. You may have been, like I said, a little guy in stature, but you're a giant when it comes to North Carolina State basketball. So thank you so much.
Well, you're so nice, and just thank you for having me on your show. Enjoy the rest of your day.
Monty, you're the best, man.
Thank you.
No, he was amazing, isn't he?
Yeah.
I mean, you can tell with a little bit of the curry that I said how much that he enjoyed that. Hearing, because you don't get a lot of compliments. People usually give them to your face. They don't always say it to someone else. And the fact that he liked that so much made me happy.
And for the listeners, they can't see it, but we were able to see Monty during the interview. And he looks like he could still play some full court basketball.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. He probably can. He's, 5'7". Stays in shape, man.
He's a tiger.
Damn right, stays in shape. He knows. Okay, anyone here think, right now, if Monty was here and there was a basketball court, do you think any of us could get points off him?
Off of him?
Yeah, like, could we score on him? You think so?
Oh, I think if we the real question is,
could we stop him?
Could we stop him?
No.
No.
Definitely not.
So
could I throw up a shot and get one of 10 to go in?
There you go.
Okay. The three of us play a 3-on-3 against him, David Thompson, and Burleson. And I know we can take him.
I like our chances.
Yeah. They are in their 70s, so we have something on them.
Yeah.
We're not that much younger.
Speak for yourself.
Okay.
Bob.
Maybe it's just me.
Self-pop.
Yeah, you can't even walk.
Whoops, there I go again.
Mark, come back.
Mark, you mentioned briefly, so let's move on to that golf story. Right. But Johnny Miller had the 10-stroke lead. He goes, double bogey, 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 mm-hmm. bogey par to end the third round. Mm-hmm. His 10-stroke lead goes down to four because his attention is waning as he's listening, or I don't know if he was listening to the game or just getting updates on the game or what.
He was listening to radio reports.
Yeah.
So, yeah, he was getting...
Mark, that was a great ad in that, too. I forgot about that. That was great.
Yeah. So, really yeah, it's that's pretty funny because, like, it's like, what iron do you want up? No, shh. What's the score now? What's the score?
Right. It's going to double overtime. Yeah.
Look how confident he was, though, that just to be able, oh, I got a 10-stroke lead. I'll listen to the game, and it's amazing, like you said, how it went down from 10 strokes to four in a blink of an eye.
Right, because you virtually can't lose a 10-stroke lead going into the final round, obviously. A 4-stroke lead, you could.
Yeah.
You could, but he certainly opened the door. In fact, he said, I'll get to the reporters. I'll give you guys a good story if I blow this tournament tomorrow.
That's right.
Being the final day. He did not. He held on. New dealer for the Red Sox. This is a story about their new manager. Owner Tom Yawkey would call every day to check from South Carolina to check on his team. The hope for the 74 team is that newly acquired Juan Marichal will start every 5 days for new manager Daryl Johnson. Did not happen. He makes just nine starts. He's 5-1, but an ERA under 5 and was released a year later after two starts with the Dodgers. The Dominican Dandy retired. So it didn't work out in Boston. There's another one of those things. I did not remember Juan Marichal with the Red Sox.
Well, to me, he's always a Giant.
It was a blink of an eye. It was the same with the Dodgers. It was a blink of an eye.
Well, with the Dodgers, I think two starts, an ERA of about 13 and done.
One. Yeah.
I remember him playing for the Dodgers. That one I would have remembered because I remember the Roseboro controversy.
That's right.
That, you know, Dodger fans were like, no, we don't want him.
Which is crazy because he hit Roseboro over the head with a bat. And if that happened today, he would have been banned from baseball.
Yeah. Oh, for sure.
Right. Yeah. Which is crazy.
Yeah. Well, and back then, it was like, you know, you really shouldn't do that.
That's right.
Next time.
Don't do that again or you'll be sitting in the corner.
Johnson, the manager of the Red Sox, was not a good player. He's one of those typical kind of backup catchers, you know, your Bruce Bochy type guys that are not good players necessarily, but take in the game. In fact, he said, I'm certain that if I had been a better ball player, a regular, I wouldn't be here now. When you're a player, you don't have time to think about the game. You have to concentrate on what you're doing. Me, I had all the time in the world to just think. Team had plenty of internal issues, but the big one was Reggie Smith. Apparently, Reggie Smith didn't like anybody or nobody liked Reggie.
Well, at least the three main players, Fisk and Tiant and Bill Lee, seemed to have issues with all of
those. The three of them.
I was at a party with Reggie Smith, and he was pretty, because it was a party, it wasn't baseball, he was pretty okay there. He was a die with the Dodgers.
Yeah.
In 77, he was one of the guys that hit the
And also, as I believe, rounds. As a coach, too.
Did you talk to Reggie about Louis Tiant?
No, I didn't.
Okay, so
it was a party.
You like everybody.
You do.
That's true. I get along with everybody.
He walked away, Reggie did, and went, who's that Mark Hoff man with two N's on the end of his name?
And a C? Now, you know, the thing is, they trade Reggie Smith to the Cardinals. Reggie Smith gets 100 RBI for the Cards. They get Bernie Carbo and Rick Wise. Sometimes those deals you get when you see them on paper at the time, you go, that looks great. But if you just see it from there, Carbo, you know, had 15 home runs, 34 RBI, and Wise was 3-4 in his first year in Boston. Mind you, he won 44 games after that. But you look sometimes at those deals and you go, man, they probably could have used Reggie Smith.
And you're in the RBI camp. You don't say RBIs.
I do. I go back.
It should be
forth.
RBI.
But I'm sorry, you know.
Because I was about to cut your mic
off. I know, that
right
was done.
Okay.
Okay, but you know, it's, you know.
I like this part about Luis Aparicio was a Hall of Fame shortstop.
White Sox.
For the White Sox. Had played a couple years in Boston. He said if he could no longer do the job that he would retire.
He did.
Maybe in a couple years.
Yeah.
He was released before opening day, never played again. 10 years later, he was in Cooperstown.
Yeah. And how many RBI did he have that year?
Yeah, as many as me.
Well, the Red Sox did finish with a winning record. They were 84-78, but the following year, that was the year they went to the World Series.
That's right.
And one of the greatest World Series ever to be played against the Reds. And even though they lost that series, who can ever forget, you know, Carlton Fisk and trying to, you know,
Show me how it's done, Mark. Get up and do it, buddy.
Stay fair. Stay fair. I'm using my hands. That'll magically make it stay fair. But
yeah, it did.
And the other big home run in that game, Bernie Carbo. Oh,
that's right. That's right.
Pinch hit 3-run homer.
That's right.
Why I know these silly things and don't know, you know, the three things on my grocery list, you know.
But that's the important things in life.
But that's when you knew. That's when you knew you love sports. Because if you come home from school and they go, "What'd you learn?" You go, "I have no idea." Well, what about? And then you go, "But I know Reggie Cleveland." You know, and they, okay. Yeah.
Up in the air, what the playoffs are. No clear-cut favorite to win the NBA championship. They said it was the first time since 1969, Bill Russell's last year, last title with the Celtics, that there was no clear-cut favorite to win the championship. You had Kareem and the Bucks, Cowens and the Celtics, and we talked about extensively with Bob Ryan. We'll talk about that finals between the Bucks and the Celtics, which is so weird to think the Bucks, I think, were in the Western Conference. Right. They played in the finals. It was a great final. We'll talk with Bob Ryan about that next month. But you also had the Knicks, the defending champs with Dave DeBuscher. The Bulls had a loaded team. They had Bob Love and Chet Walker.
Jerry Sloan.
Yeah, right. Norm Van Leer. Right. And then the Pistons had Bing and Bob Lanier. But, yeah, so a lot of good teams.
And there was a great NBA Finals that year, and there were some really good games. But the NBA was still not – it was this third-tier sport, you know, behind baseball and football. And it took Magic and Bird to elevate the game.
Right. Yeah.
But
they changed the game, for
right?
Sure.
But in '74, it was the playoffs were great. But again, it was just like, oh, that's nice. But you know, it just didn't have the cha-ching, I guess, that it has now.
I guess what stood out to me was the fact that Lucius Allen hurt his knee skidding on a warm-up jacket. If that happened nowadays,
right?
Whoever left that warm-up jacket there would be gone. I mean, Lucius Allen was their one of their key guys, and the fact that he was missing the rest of the playoffs over something like that.
Well, I always think about this, so. They probably used to just, you know, take off their warm-ups and they'd just throw them down or whatever, and then they'd play, and there it is.
And a ball boy would pick it up.
Well, they do, because Lucius Allen ripped up his knee in 1974, we can't have, so it's all this learning process about how they go through things. But, yeah, that Bob Ryan alluded to how that had quite an effect.
There was a rugby story.
Oh, yeah.
And the reason the bloody, it was a 2-day 32 team battle royale that got all bloody in Monterey. But the thing I remember
about,
1974 was the year of the
streakers.
And we had two of them at that.
Up here streaking one day, Mark, and we're done.
Mark loves these men streakers, too. So
I do, because I streak all the time.
Yes. Man.
You're naked right now, which is sort of odd.
That gets us to part three of the Babe Ruth series. We've started with his time in Boston and when he was sold to the Yankees, and then his first years in New York, and he basically just changed the game like no player has ever changed probably any sport. His marriage has fallen apart. In 1925, He collapses in spring training with what was known as the bellyache round the world and had abdominal surgery. The team was bad despite it being the rookie season for a player by the name of Lou Gehrig. The surgery and his marital strife taking a toll on the Babe's play. In July, he's hitting just 250, not much power. Believe it or not, people are thinking, maybe this kind of out of shape slugger is done.
Well, the thing is, his numbers weren't like they when he first started with the Yankees. He changed everything, and then there was a little bit of that lull,
right?
And then he kicked it back up again.
Yeah, they thought he was done. He was definitely not done. From 1926 to 1931, mm-hmm. 1931, he hit 354 and averaged 50 home runs. 155 RBIs.
I think he started to work out again, and because he realized he was getting a little heavy, and tried to get himself in better shape. And I think one of the seasons he came in at like 210 pounds, which was like the lowest he had weighed, like, you know, maybe since it's rookie ball. But there was a rumor going around that apparently I don't think was true, that the Yankees actually added pinstripes because they wanted to make Babe look thinner.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. That was in this article, that the owner did that just for that reason. They also put numbers on the back of jerseys, and they were like, well, you know, they didn't ask what number you want. They're like, oh, Ruth, you hit number three. You're number three.
Yep.
Yeah.
Garrick, you hit cleanup. You're number four, and so on. So he hits 60 home runs in 1927. The team, as a team, the Yankees hit 307. Still a record. They go 110-44. He wins the home run title over Lou Gehrig. Just an unbelievable season. 1929, Helen and him have been estranged for a while, but not divorced because they're both Catholic. He didn't believe in divorce, despite him having a relationship with another woman. Helen dies in a fire because of some faulty electrical work done on the house.
And apparently Babe cried, you know, the funeral was devastating to him.
But a few months later, he marries that woman, Claire. Mm-hmm. His play begins to deteriorate, you know, after the 31 season. And, you know, think of this. I mean, whenever you think you aren't expendable, Babe Ruth was sold. After all he did for New York, he was sold back to Boston, the Boston Braves this time, in 1935, and his time in New York was over. He only had 72 at-bats in Boston. On May 25th, he hit three home runs against Pittsburgh, the last three home runs of his career, numbers 712, 713, and 714. 5 days later, he would play his last game. To his dismay, he never got to manage. He really wanted the opportunity to manage. And for some reason, you would think that a guy with that, I mean, I know he was a party boy and maybe they just didn't think, but you would think that they would know that he could really relate to the guys.
Right. But remember when we were talking with Linda, she had mentioned that he really wanted to integrate the team that he took over as a manager.
That's right.
And Commissioner Landis didn't want any of that.
No.
So that could have been a big reason why he didn't get a manager job.
Yeah.
I just think this whole series on Babe Ruth has changed the way I look at him. He was always just a stern slugger guy, but it just the stuff that you learned about him, he was a fun-loving, kind man. I mean, the one reporter said that he was one of the most exciting people who make life fun and who give more life than they take from it. You know, and then whatever Jimmy Dykes had once said about the Roger Maris home run chase, that Maris is a fine ball player, but he can't imagine him driving down Broadway in a low-slung convertible wearing a coonskin coat. Yeah. You know, there's a whole now different world of Babe Ruth when I think of him now than what I did before we actually talked to Linda or read this article.
I just love the fact that, you know, he made so much more money than all the other guys, basically more than everyone combined.
And the president.
They never picked up a check. Right. He took care of all of them. Like, nobody had to pay for anything in his presence. That's just how you want to think that you would be if you had that kind of money.
But I'm trying to think who is the closest to Babe Ruth, not in terms of like dominating a sport, but the personality. Muhammad Ali. I'm also thinking Charles Barkley.
Yeah, that's fair.
Because
that's
Charles would pick up the tab for anyone.
I will tell you, we went to a party many years ago that Barkley was at. We got to know Barkley. He took us to all the parties, paid for everything, and then the next day it was a golf tournament, one of those celebrity golf tournaments. Mm-hmm. He goes, Bill, Tina, he goes, meet me here tomorrow, and we'll go to the golf tournament. We laughed. We didn't show up. We showed up on Sunday. Charles from across the lobby goes, Bill, Tina. He walks over and goes, I told you guys to show up yesterday. Why didn't you? Where were you? Yeah. It's just I think, Mark, you hit that. That's a nail in the head.
Well, that was actually a setup, like where I actually knew about that story and I wanted to set it up for you.
Teed it up. It's all because of the naked comments.
That's right.
In June of 48, sick with cancer, the Babe makes his last appearance at Yankee Stadium. 2 months later, the Babe passed away.
I want to just say he passed away, and his body lay in state at mm-hmm. Yankee Stadium so the fans could come visit him. Would they ever do that? Can you think of any player nowadays on any team that they would do that nowadays?
No.
No.
That's absolutely incredible. I think they did it with Gehrig, too.
And what's interesting is he made all this money, and there's the famous saying, I think, when he was first getting six figures, they say, hey, you're making more than the president. Well, I had a better year than the president.
Right.
So he's making, if you put it in today's dollars, a lot of money. But the athlete has seemed a little more spoiled today than it was back then. Right. And I think that's why the fans could relate to them.
Yeah.
Because with Babe, you could go up and talk to him. Today, a normal fan, it's hard for them to go up to a superstar athlete and talk to them.
And Babe wanted people to talk to him. Right. He didn't avoid that. A lot of times if we see a player sitting at a Cheesecake Factory, you know you're not going to probably go up and talk to him because they don't want to hear from you. So,
yeah,
you know.
That's true. You know, some of these articles, I have to admit, you have to kind of like force yourself to finish them. And then there are some like this, all three, that they were just really fun to learn about.
It gave you a new perspective.
Yeah. Anything on the people section?
Oh, I got to go back. The Matador gets a new uniform.
Tell me.
Well, the Matador clothes used to always have to be thrown away. No. Not the new clothes. They absorb nothing. The blood simply just dries and cakes on the exterior of the jacket and can be chipped or brushed off. One Matador simply has his jacket hung up, then takes a garden hose to it. So there you go. No more blood on a Matador's uniform. That's what they came up with. Or no more.
I'm sure the Bull was really excited to hear
that.
Yes.
Yes. I mean, I just, after that, I thought, man, back in 75, hey, man, blood on me. We'll figure a way to not keep that on there.
Yeah. I love that. That's awesome.
Hey.
Hey, Frank DeFord has an article here towards the end where he was offered a job to be on air in the early 70s at WBZ TV in Boston. It's a great article. It's almost, you know, I can't do it justice here. If for anyone that likes that kind of stuff, go ahead and read it. But
where did you work in Boston?
I worked at WBZ TV in Boston. Not 50 years ago. I was 5. But he said there were only two really good on-air people at the time, Warner Wolf in Washington and Bill Curry in Pittsburgh. Curry told DeFord, after his first telecast in Pittsburgh, that he got a call from a higher-up that said he looked like hell on screen. So he took him to a store, got him a makeup artist to do some work on him, and then taught him how to do his own makeup. So he bought all this makeup. He brings it back down, puts it in the drawer, never uses it. 2 weeks later, the higher-up comes up to him. See, Bill, I told you. That makeup makes a big difference. He had never touched any of it.
Yeah, so, you're right. Yeah,
you know,
yeah, yeah.
These higher ups in local news are, we've all dealt with who they're talking about.
And the thing is, back in that day, he had no respect for the sports people. But when we grew up, the sports guy was sort of an icon. The Jim Hills, the Fred Rogans, to me it was Ted Dawson. There were guys every week, Tony Hernandez, you didn't miss nightly.
He also had an audition at the WABC with a guy named Al Primo, who said, you know, Frank, you're funny looking.
Yeah, that's right.
So he didn't get the job there, which is kind of funny. But anyway, just a great article on local sports news from back in the day.
I wanted to go back to the people section real quick. There was one article on Pat Bolin, who was an assistant female coach of the Loyola College girls basketball team, and she punched a male referee. Mm-hmm. She was really upset after losing the game. They, you know, she delivered a fist to the stomach, and she said in defense that she hadn't hit the referee that hard because if I really let him have it, he would still be out.
Wow.
Yeah. So there is one person you don't mess with.
No.
There's actually some interesting ones in the people one with that the Yugoslavian soccer star tried his hand at bullfighting.
Mm-hmm.
He got knocked over. I don't. Nowadays, could you picture any athlete, any team saying, "Hey, Mike Trout, get in there with him."
And the other thing is, if you don't know country music, Charlie Pride was a fantastic Western artist and stuff, but he also played baseball, and he was a really good baseball player, and he was in the Angels organization.
Yeah, he was. He was. Yeah. He actually, and he got a couple hits off Jim Palmer.
Right.
Yep. You know, so I did the one with the do or diet for the old home team. How to eat if you want to start running marathons. You know, so for breakfast, you could have, if this is a Whalen diet, you could have sour milk and fresh fruit. Yummy, Mark.
Mm.
Lunch, whole grain cereal.
Mm-hmm.
Dinner, potatoes baked or boiled in their skins.
Okay.
You know,
oh,
see?
Yummy.
Yeah, you're only supposed to have 2,000 calories or less because you want to be 20% below your average weight for height. That's, I mean, I've never been, I mean, I've ran a half marathon, but to think that's the type of stuff you have to eat and your day ends with drinking sour milk again.
Oh, that sour milk would do it for me.
Oh, yeah, I read that and I thought, well, hey, good for them. That's probably why they win all the time.
No, thank you. For the record, faces in the crowd before we say goodbye?
Yeah, there was nothing actually in the faces in the crowd that, though I'm sure I'm going to get a letter from Tom Reynolds' family saying,
yes.
Why the heck did you not mention me? Okay, no. I'll mention you. He played for Mainland Regional High basketball team in New Jersey and set a state record by hitting 30 consecutive free throws. So there you go.
I saw that and I was thinking he hit 30 free throws in a row to get his percentage up to 80%. He must have sucked before he hit the 30. All of a sudden it just clicked. So that's, you know, people forget that when Wilt had his 100-point game, you know, Wilt was a horrible free throw shooter, but I think in that game he was like 28 for 32 or something like that. Right. That was the key to him getting 100 points. So speaking of getting to 100 points, North Carolina State, in that game that they almost lost David Thompson to, that was against Pitt. They won that 100-72, and that propelled them. They then beat Providence, I think, then UCLA. And then they won the national championship by beating Marquette. Wonderful conversation with Coach Towe, who you can just still see he lights up when talking about that team.
It was a great interview.
Hey, you get someone on, and we've had a few of them, that their enthusiasm makes us feel enthused. It's not like they're going, yeah, it was just a great time at NC State. No, he almost puts you in the stands when he was playing back then.
He's perfect because when we say past our prime, we're talking about the three of us.
Yes.
Yeah. We're not talking about our guests.
No.
And that is certainly the case with Monty. You can tell his prime is still in the present tense.
Yes, we got the full Monty today.
That goes with your streaking thing, buddy.
That's right. That's the bare truth, the bare facts.
You're a sicko.
I am.
You're nuts.
Hey, for Bill and Bill, Mark, my name's Scott. We'll see you next week on the Past Our Prime podcast.
See ya.
Bye.